Welcome everyone to session 21. So wonderful for all of you to join us. Today we continue with the series that Cristof began last session. And without further ado, over to you, Cristof.
I'm always surprised how wonderful these introductions are. So we are, welcome from me too. And we are continuing on last week's topic. We had started to study the Upakilesa Sutta, that is the sermon, the discourse of the Buddha that's denoted or in the Majjhima Nikaya, the collection of middle length sayings, number 128. And so we had started the sutta has three parts. Last time I called them 1A, 1B, and part 2. Last time we did the 1A part where the Buddha walked away from a not very peaceful monastic situation, where he said bye to everybody who was kind of fighting and quarreling. And even though he had gone there to the quarreling parties and had tried to make peace, they basically said, mind your own business, Mr. Buddha. And so he said, well then, I'm out of here.
To and each his own.
Exactly. But he uttered some words as he left the scene. And when I read those words as they were depicted, they seem to be completely without any anger, without any remorse or other kinds of, let's say, unwholesome feelings. And so, that was very inspiring to kind of, in a very calm manner, go away from a situation that's just not conducive for peaceful living.
And he did try a few times to
resolve
the situation.
Exactly. He did try to resolve the situation. And it seems... So the story is 2,500 years old, but it seems so out of today's life, like out of probably for all times, in all times. It's a very personal story. Like, I think I can relate to it. And I think all of us have been in situations where we were in a quarreling party and somebody kind of not involved came and wanted to mediate, wanted to arbitrate. And we said, it's none of your business, you know, what do you even know? And sent them away, even though we know when we're in a calm state of mind that when we have a bird's eye view, when we kind of zoom out of a situation, look at it from a distance, it makes sense to listen to someone else who is not emotionally involved. And we have been in the situation of that arbitrator and try to resolve situations, try to help, and then be faced with kind of backlash, words of disrespect, and kind of that's hurts. That hurts because we feel like, oh, we, you know, just listen to me, just you know, get over your anger and listen. And it hurts, and you
I'm
know,
just here to help.
Yeah,
I think, and yeah.
Right. And as we know, when in either situation, in either party, kind of we hurt. Somebody is hurt, and when we're hurting, we tend to hurt other people in our words, in our thoughts, and maybe even in our actions. So that is inspiring that the Buddha kind of showed us a way how to behave in a situation like that when hurt is easy to be experienced, but overcome that and move away basically as a last resort solution for one's own sanity. So then the story continues. Again, we're moving to 1B of the sutta. The Buddha leaves the riled up scene in this town of Kosambi, and he wanders off. And apparently he makes two stops in his move on. From what I've seen online, these places are fairly close together, so you can reach them with maybe an hour walk or half an hour walk or something like that. So it's not like far, far away. He didn't wander for days, but just like within that day in the morning, he left that quarreling scene And then he first reaches a hermit monk, and he kind of, he welcomes him, he hosts him, he greets him with respect. And how does that look like in the times of the Buddha? He basically, you welcome somebody, give them a seat, and you give them a bowl of water to wash your feet. Because the monks, they were not, most of them were not even wearing sandals. They just had their robes and their alms bowl, and that's it. So they had dirty feet, and of course it's nice to wash them after a walk. And that's kind of the part of the customary greeting. And then once this kind of arrival has happened, then a conversation starts. And it usually, the customary greeting between monks is goes like that. Like the more senior monk says to the other one, I hope you are keeping well, bhikkhu. Bhikkhu is the word for monk, fully ordained monk. I hope you're comfortable. I hope you're not having any trouble getting alms food. So upon which the other venerable replies, if appropriate, if correct, I am keeping well, blessed one, meaning dear Buddha, I am comfortable and I'm not having trouble getting alms food. Basically, they're checking in on each other in regards of health, in regards of their abode, whether they have an abode to be protected from the elements, and whether they have enough to eat. It's kind of like the 2,500-year-old version of, how you doing? I'm doing well. Or like, couldn't be better. Right? Right. So,
howdy, mate.
Howdy. Right. So then it's kind of this scene is very, in the sutta, kind of very short, and it doesn't do much more than to show how like a greeting can take place between two venerables. The recluse then receives a teaching by the Buddha on meditation and life, and apparently the Buddha motivates him to continue with his practice, with his solitary life. He basically gives him a Dhamma talk, and after which the Buddha moves on, like his business, his job is done there. And so he moves on, and again, near, I don't know how far away, but somewhere reachable within maybe an hour or two, he reaches a place called Eastern Bamboo Park. That is the residence of, at least in this moment, the residence of three monks, like a small monastic community. And there they have some, like the park is overseen by some kind of park ranger, like a park warden. And the Buddha approaches, and the park keeper says, oh, dear venerable, don't disturb my three monks here. Please stay out. So obviously he doesn't recognize that it's the Buddha, right? He just says, please stay out. These people here live in peace. Let them live in peace. So that kind of shows us how much indistinguishable the Buddha looked in those days. Like for somebody who didn't know him, he just looked like a simple monk, like any other monk, you know? So there's nothing exterior that is really putting him apart. Like it's a person like everyone else. But one of the senior monk of the group of monks living there, he's called Venerable Anaruddha. He overhears the conversation of the park keeper, comes to the scene and says, hey, dear, like with very friendly words, he basically informs the park keeper, hey, dear park keeper, you're doing a fantastic job, but this is our very revered teacher, so you can let him in. So he gets to go inside, and it's very, very lovely. Like he comes from this quarreling scene of monks in the morning that he left in the morning. And now after this little stop in between, he comes to this very, very ideal community, the ideal monastic community. And basically all three monks of that East Bamboo Park come together with their guest of honor. And they have the same ritual again, right? They offer him a seat, they give him a washing bowl for his feet, and they do these greetings like before, like, I hope you're keeping well, like, how you doing? Couldn't be better. And then the and then after that the Buddha asks them about their home, about their monastic harmony. Very interesting that he asks them that, probably because that's like fresh off his mind, right? Yeah. So it's like, okay, so how about you? Are you living in peace? And they respond that they get along very peacefully. So he asks them, how do you do that? How do you achieve that? And then they point out a few attitudes and actions that bring about that concord. And I want to read them to you.
And it's Anuruddha, the main monk, right?
It's responding back. That's how I understand it. It's the senior monk of that group, Anuruddha. He responds back, but in the very end, the other two chime in that they see it the same way.
Okay.
And so basically he says, in my words, he says, our attitude is to keep in mind at all times how fortunate we are to live with like-minded companions. So they practice gratitude. That's number one. Number two is they do acts of kindness for each other, whether seen or unseen by the recipient or other observers. Number three, they speak kindly and gently with each other and about each other, again, whether in public or in private. Number four is they think good thoughts about each other and send good wishes to each other. Basically, they're practicing metta meditation. And when they think about themselves, they're not trying to think like, oh, he did this wrong, this is a bad monk. But they say like, oh, this is a good monk. He did this and this and this. He's meditating with me. Like basically they're focusing in their thoughts also on all the good properties, all the good traits in each other. And number five, they do want and they behave like the other community members would prefer it. And basically helping each other at all times with chores, with basically actively helping to keep harmony. And then in the sutta, the other monks, they summarize the effects of these guidelines for a harmonious community by saying, that is how, venerable sir, we are living in concord with mutual appreciation, without disputing, blending like milk and water, viewing each other with kindly eyes. And then they go on explaining a little more in detail how they share chores. And we know how like the sharing of chores can be a big point of disharmony within housemates, right? So they explain it like they explain how they do it. And they say, venerable sir, as to that, meaning the chores, whichever of us returns first from the village with alms food prepares the seats, sets out the water for drinking and for washing, and puts the refuse bucket in its place. Whichever of us returns last eats any food left over if he wishes, otherwise he throws it away. He puts away the seats and the water for drinking and for washing. He puts away the refuse bucket. That's an important thing for monks. It's like, you know, it's called, I think in Ajahn Brahm, he comes from Britain and they call it a spittoon, basically where the waste of goes from eating and from not wanting to eat. So he puts away the refuse bucket after washing it and he sweeps out the refectory. Whoever notices that the pot of water for drinking, washing, or the latrine are low or empty, takes care of them. If they are too heavy for him, he calls someone else by a signal of the hand and they move it by joining hands. But because of this, we do not break out into speech. But every 5 days, we sit together all night discussing the Dhamma, the Buddha's teachings. So in other words, everything needs to be done when he realizes it needs to be done. And without fretting, keeping score, like, oh, you did last time, or I did last time, you have to do it today. No, if it needs to be done, and I'm here, I'll do it.
Whoever sees it.
Whoever sees it, yeah. And of course, for that, it helps that they have their routines, their monastic routines and structures, so that kind of the chores are very easy to be seen. And yeah, and they're not many, because there's not the point of being in a monastic, obviously, is having not so many responsibilities. So you can meditate a lot. And with little responsibilities comes also the opportunity to, you know, whether I do it every day, what this has to be done here, you know, who cares? It's like it takes 5 minutes or so and everything is good. So, and then that's the chores. But in this paragraph, it also says about that they talk about their common interest, their goal, their progress. They all want to make progress in the spiritual liberation. And for that, they sit together and talk about it regularly. About everything else, they only talk when really necessary and when it's beneficial. So that kind of makes sure that one of the previous points, basically, so that only kind words can come out of their mouths, is aided. So that's the ideal monastic community. The Buddha comes from worst to best, and it's presented in this sutta wonderfully. And now what can we learn from that, right? So how can we live a harmonious life with our husband, with our wife, with, I don't know, kids, with whatever roommate or neighbors that we have? And I put them together in my words again in 7 points. First, keep an attitude of gratitude that you have like-minded people around you, that you have generally very nice and welcoming people around you. And so that's number one. Second is do good and without expecting anything in return, without keeping records, without keeping track, basically. Third is speak kindly to each other and about each other. The fourth is to think good thoughts about each other, focusing on the good traits about one another, and to send good thoughts to each other with the practice of metta. Number 5 is to help each other whenever possible. Number 6, do the chore at hand without keeping track. That's a good one. I love that one. Somehow it makes me giggle. And the 7th is have meaningful conversations. You know, when you talk, let it be meaningful. About a shared interest or goal. For example, like as kind of an important talk, of course, in a non-monastic situation, you'll have more talking to each other because there's more logistics to talk about. And obviously that also builds relations, right? Even a conversation about nothing kind of has a meaning to build a relationship. So I'm not saying you shouldn't talk like the monastics most of the times do, but be aware that when you talk and it's kind of about nothing important, really, it's for the purpose of building a relation. And then we can think, is it kind of right now appropriate, or is it too much, or is it too little? So that is kind of the chatter, let's say. And then about once in a while, we have to really speak about important issues that are common to both of us, or to all three of us, or to the whole community, like a common interest or a common goal. All right, is that easy to implement, those 7 points? Sometimes it is, sometimes it isn't, of course. It's a practice. We gradually become better at it. We slip at times, and there's no need to feel bad about it. We're not perfect. We want to get better and better at it. But if we need to, we apologize and just start the practice again. Important is here to realize, because the question could come up, yeah, I can behave like that, but what if the other doesn't? Good question. At one point, you will probably, if that kind of continues and you can't live with it, then you gotta have consequences. Either throw the other one out or leave yourself. Or maybe you want to first talk about rules or whatever. Well, you'll find you can think of your own appropriate consequences. There's no single one way, right? And so, yeah, but it's in your own hands. This is about taking responsibility for creating harmony. These 7 points, and if you want to study them again, we have a handout again. We have the download, the PDF download again, and it'll be on the blog and in the email that we'll send you. You can review them. And these are 7 points that give you power to take back the responsibility for a harmonious partnership, for a harmonious household, for a harmonious neighborhood, and maybe even a wider community, maybe even a country or the world. But of course, we in this kind of thing, in this kind of attitude, it's matter. In this kind of matter, it's probably helpful to think small, and you know, because we all can do our part, and we can do it in our own small little world, and that can then spread out. So it's in our power, basically. That's what I want to say with that. oh yeah, the final point brings us back to meditation, of course. the harmony at home, or the harmony around us, is very essential if we want to deepen our meditation practice. The harmony around us, it provides for a calm and peaceful mind, right? Because it's undisturbed, at least by the immediate surrounding. The calmer and more peaceful our mind is outside of meditation, the deeper we can get in meditation. And again, what's the point of that? The deeper our meditation is, the more insight we can gain by being absorbed in these deep states of meditation. And we can bring that insight then back into everyday life and live a happier life. So that's the part 1B. And then there's like the second, the very, very meaty part. It's already meaty, I guess. There's so much in that sutta. But in that second part, the Buddha now continues on talking to those three monks and teaching them in detail how they can overcome some obstacles that keep them from having very deep states of meditation. And that's phenomenally interesting.
That's juicy.
That's juicy. We'll do that next time, probably next week. And but for now, let's practice meditation.
Can I just say something?
Yes.
Before we move to meditation?
Of course.
So, no, you can keep it on. You can answer.
Okay.
So the 7 points that you outlined that the Buddha is advising on how to live a harmonious life, it essentially is nothing unfamiliar. Like, we know this. Our mothers raised us knowing this. We teach our children this. So it's nothing unfamiliar, but it's still hard to maintain.
Yeah. Right. And it helps to recall it.
Yeah.
And know that with that, we are in the power to do something for the harmony. We can go beyond the blame or blaming others and just say, hey, let me at least work on my side and make the situation better.